The opinions expressed on the Simone Edwards Show by our guests are solely the opinions of the original source who expressed them. They do not necessarily represent the opinions of the station, its owners, and/or the Simone Edwards Show and those affiliated with it. In no event will the Simone Edwards Show, this station, its owners, guests, hosts, or affiliates be liable for the information disseminated on the program, including, without limitation, any loss or damage, indirect or otherwise, arising from information presented on the show. We trust you are of legal age and will consult appropriate professionals prior to employing any opinion expressed on the show. Many of the topics discussed are personal in nature, and some people may disagree with the opinions expressed on the show. We are open to your constructive criticism and or ideas for future radio programs. Please feel free to email us at thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. Again, that's thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. All right, everybody. We are here in studio with Kristi Hines Baker of Kristi Love Connection. I am so excited. I feel like Oprah. We got Kristi in the house. I just absolutely love her business slash ministry. That's really what I'm going to call it. Yes. It's a business, but you minister to the needs of women in such an amazing way that I can't wait for our audience to meet you. So without further ado, I want to present to some and introduce to others, Miss Kristi Hines Baker. Kristi, say hello.
Hello, hello, hello.
So let's get to know you a little bit before we jump off into the deep end. Okay. Where are you from?
San Diego, born and raised.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Born and raised, San Diego.
Okay. So tell us, for those of us that, you know, transplants like myself, tell us a little bit about San Diego. How has it evolved?
Oh, boy. Like downtown and everything. Okay, well, first of all, I'm from the hood in San Diego.
Okay.
Okay, born and raised. Euclid Avenue, all of that, Imperial, all of that. Born and raised there. Lived there all of my life. My parents had a home 32 years.
Yeah.
I didn't move out until then, actually then, you know, with a purchase of my own.
Right.
That's the only reason why I moved.
Okay.
And we actually had our family home when both of my parents passed away, all of that stuff. So, but San Diego has evolved. Oh, my God, it's crazy. Downtown is crazy. And I see what I'm enjoying is now that I've moved out into Murrieta in an Empire area, mm-hmm. what I enjoy is coming back and seeing my neighborhood being upgraded a little bit. I see that going on. You know, it's taking its time, but I do see it. So I'm excited about that because I am a community person and I consider my community still in the hood.
Okay, that's good though.
Really.
So the metropolis that I see today, or that I've seen, you know, in the last like decade or so that I've been here, mm-hmm. wasn't like that when.
Mm-mm. Like for instance, the prime example, the Jacobs Center.
Right.
That was not there.
Okay.
You have the Euclid Trolley Station. That's famous for just being the Euclid Trolley Station.
Right.
But like those types of things. I see upgrades going even further, I guess that's west. Further west, like on Market Street, Imperial, they're building up.
Okay.
Over there, Imperial around there, where the now, famous cemetery in San Diego, Mount Hope and all of that kind of mm-hmm. stuff, all of that build up over there, Home Depot, all that kind of stuff, that's stuff that was not there when I grew up.
Okay.
You know, we had the little penny candy shops and stuff like that, but now we're getting, you know, major stuff. So I love seeing it. And every time I drive through, I'm like, oh my God, that's changed. Even in the Lemon Grove area.
Okay.
See some upgrades. So awesome.
And I love that you're so community focused that you're still kind of like, we. You refer to it as though you're still.
I am. I've been gone 8 years, but it's nothing like San Diego. It's nothing like home. It's nothing like it. I know so many people.
Right.
You know, all that stuff. I don't forget it. And when the community builds up, or if anything's community events in San Diego, and I can be a part of it, I try to be a part of it still.
Okay.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yes.
So now you grew up a PK.
Yep. Born and raised.
What was that like?
Again.
Yeah.
Okay. So my father was the founder of Pilgrim Progressive Baptist Church.
Okay.
Now, the Foxworths are there, but. Started it many, many moons ago. So I grew up in church. One thing I will say interesting about being a PK, and that is part of my ministry, is sometimes you feel abandonment issues. And I say that because my father was present, mm-hmm. yet absent.
Got it.
So when you got a revival, you're gone. Mm-hmm. That could be one revival in one city and a revival in the next. So you could be gone 2 weeks out of the month.
Right, right, right.
My mother worked postal service 30 years, always gone. It's one of those, you know, the era that I grew up, latchkey kid. I come home from school. I was bussed out to another area for Spanish, come home, that kind of stuff. So I kind of went through, and I'm transparent about it and I'm open about it, feelings of you have two parents in the home, but you're feeling abandoned. You're feeling like I'm all alone, like those types of things. And I'm the youngest of 6 children.
Wow.
And my oldest sister is 62.
Wow.
So they basically like, okay, while my parents work, come on, Chris, go with me. Go with me, go with me, go with me.
Right.
But you still don't have that parent.
Got it.
Then when I was 12, my father passed. My mother passed 8 years ago. So, you know, you go through those types of things, and your church family is your family, but you get that, you know, church is what it is. But I feel it made me stronger, and I'm able to help somebody with what I, when I say it, when I talk about it. I've met other pastors' wives and different things like that who have helped me with those issues, because I really was like, you know, you just, you start feeling like you don't really, I felt like I belonged somewhere, but you feel like, why did he have to do that so much? What about me? Those types of things. So, but I'm grateful to God because I've been healed of all of that.
Right.
And now I'm over to help somebody else and talk to somebody else about it and be open about it, because it's there.
That's really
good. Really there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so let's segue a little bit and talk about, because of the abandonment issues, how did that affect your relationship with God, and how did you get to a place of healing to where you can... You're not mad at God about it, but you were able to. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So talk to us about that journey.
Okay.
Your journey to wholeness.
In 83, my father passed. I'm 12 years old.
Right.
In another year, I'm going to graduate from junior high school. Mm-hmm. And my father has a heart attack and passes away.
Wow.
So when that happened, I felt like, oh my God, now he's really gone. Mm-hmm. I've always felt like he wasn't there, kind of like, you know.
Yeah.
And my father was a good, good man. Provider, all of those things, but it's what I felt.
Right.
It's not about, you know what I mean?
Right, it's not about the facts,
exactly.
About what you felt about the facts.
What I felt about them, exactly. So, with that being said, at that time, so that's 12 years old, right? Mm-hmm. Fast forward to like 18, when I'm graduating from high school, all of those things.
Right.
And you hear people say such good things. And the legacy of my father was great. Mm-hmm. You hear people saying such good things, and I'm thinking, but what about me?
Right.
And it's been all of these years, Simone.
Right.
This was what was hard for me.
Right.
Because then I started feeling anger, resentment.
Right.
And he's been buried
all
of those years.
Right.
But I had to work through it. Right. In order to move on.
Right.
So I joined a ministry, and my pastor and a bishop and first lady were very essential to my healing. Talked to me vividly, candidly, all of those things, and helped me work through. I was able to share how I felt. Because you can't really share because, again, he my father is a legend, and people know him. You know what I mean? So you don't want to spread something negative about a negative view, again, about my feeling.
Right.
So they were very essential in helping me and get through that prayer. And finally, I was healed from it, delivered, restored, all of those things.
Right.
And because you got to go through your family members, your everything.
Right.
You know, your older sisters who have the same father, different mother. They're like, you're crazy. No, I'm not. This is what I felt.
Right.
But, and then you got generational. You got that older thing where you don't say things.
Right.
You don't do things. Kristi, you stir in a pot.
Right.
But I'm a realist, and in order for people to move on.
Girl, give me a high five.
Yes, and be set free from things in order to be good, and, you know, to be, you. it's so many different pieces to people. It's so many different, right. all of that to people. And you can be broken on one side and okay on the other and good at my job, but I got a dream and a business. And it's just so many, you know, but you got to be real about things. And right. that's just how I feel. I mean, that's how I think I made it over. I've been right. transparent, no matter who, what family member, no matter what. Mm-hmm. Even my mother was living. So at mm-hmm. that point, you know, she was like, Chris, you shouldn't do that. And I'm like, Mom, I got to say this to get this out so that I can be healed.
Right.
Thank you, Jesus. It's been done. You know, it's done. But sharing my testimony always blesses someone where I'm able to share with them and help them make it through. And because I am transparent, they know I'm not judging.
Right.
I'm just saying, let's get us together so right. that we can move forward. Because we right. still got time here. That means we got something else to do.
Exactly. I love the fact that you talk about being a realist, because so often it's, you know, you can deal with sweeping things under the rug to the point where now you have like Mount Everest under a rug, and we're going to pretend that it's yes. not there.
Yes.
And it's kind of like, but that doesn't help nope. anybody.
You're tripping over Mount Everest and right. you won't even try to get some help with it. Right. You got to get some help.
Right.
Yes.
So I absolutely love that. And then the other part of your testimony that I really can relate to and I really value is the sense of it is your story.
Yes.
You know what I mean? It is your story. And so often, you're right. You can't tell, for our listeners, you can't always tell everybody your story, because if they're seeing it from their perspective, mm-hmm. you know, somebody who had a great relationship with their parent
right.
is not going to completely understand right. the pain of, I love my father. He was in the home with me,
right.
but I felt like he wasn't there. I didn't feel like daddy's little girl. I didn't feel like
yeah.
I had a special place in his heart. Mm-hmm. Even though you did, you mm-hmm. didn't feel it. And so you had to work through that.
Right. I remember a story, marching in the church choir. Mm-hmm. I've sang all my life. Mm-hmm. Marching in the church choir. And one of the, you know, you youth, teenagers, mm-hmm. one of the little girls called me fat.
Wow.
And I said, I rose up. Mm-hmm. I got a temper. Lord, help me with that too. Not a temper, but just like, I'm going to check you. You're not going to disrespect me. That
right.
kind of stuff.
Right.
So I'm like, I'm going to say something. He comes out of the office. And instead of saying something to her who called me a name, he slapped me and said, get yourself together. You're about to march into church. Get it together. I felt like that was like somebody had stabbed me.
Right.
Because you didn't take up for me. And she was wrong. You
right.
see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So those types yeah. of things, when I know that he loved me, he wanted me to get in line.
Mm-hmm.
But yet and still, you didn't ever do anything to say her in front of me to let me know that I was all right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And so that does take healing.
Mm-hmm.
That does take a process to go through.
It does.
Yeah. So how did you get that, your relationship with, you know what I mean? How did you get your relationship with God fixed through all of that?
Prayer.
Yeah.
A lot of prayer, a lot of talking, a lot of talking to him and letting him, you got to have quiet time.
Right.
You got to separate everything and sit down and let it and listen.
Right.
We're so busy
mm-hmm.
till we don't listen.
Right.
And you have to have that time. I had to let him heal me from that.
Yeah.
Yes, because I know what type of man he was. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you just, you know how older, I'm really into generational because I'm diversity at my job too.
Yeah.
So I'm really into studying, you know, what they believed and what they thought.
Right. Like right. That. It's a really interesting study mm-hmm. when you look at the four generations that are in the workplace.
Now, it's almost five.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you have those traditionalists still there,
yeah.
then you got this new, what they're calling, Generation Z or something?
Right.
In, and they don't know, look, high, you know, their thing is all electronic, all, you know, all
yeah.
that kind of stuff. So it's really, really interesting, you know, that part of it, that generational thing. So I try to understand why. I think that helped me.
Right.
I know that helped me.
Right.
Understand maybe his thought process
right.
on things at that point.
Right.
But one thing that's big and what I do know in the church community
mm-hmm.
is sometimes, you know, you don't know how to separate family from that. It's just all, I got to do church work.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to remember us
right.
as family members.
Right.
You got to remember us. You have to. And I believe God would love us to have balance too. You
right.
know what I mean? That's just like work-life balance, all that kind of stuff.
Right.
I believe there should be some type of balance.
Got it.
In that. So that wife, that daughter, that
mm-hmm.
son
mm-hmm.
knows, hey, you're important.
Right.
Yeah, it's not just everything that.
Right.
Because then it don't leave them feeling abandoned or.
That's good.
Present, but not.
Right.
Yes.
That's really good.
Yes.
That's really good. We are at the 1 minute mark. I really hope that something you've heard so far has been encouraging to you, has helped you, has even brought clarity to your situation. One of the things that I really like that you said, Kristi, about your relationship with God and fixing that was that you had to, not only could you talk to him and you told him how you really felt, which is transparency. Because sometimes we can be transparent with everybody else, but God.
Think he don't know.
Right.
He already knows.
Like, he really knows how you really, really, really feel.
Exactly.
But then I like the fact that you also said that we need to sit down and listen and be quiet, because it's in the quietness that you can hear what the answers are.
Yep. So much noise all around. Yes.
Yeah. All right, so we are going to take a break for station identification. We will be back in just a moment, and then we're going to jump into the deep end. We're going to find out about how KLC got started, how it evolved, how long she's been in business, give you entrepreneurs, you budding entrepreneurs, some tips, and help you avoid some of the pitfalls. So we have all that coming up, as well as fashion tips with the lady herself, Kristi Love of Kristi Love Connections. We'll be back.
You are listening to the San Diego Station of Inspiration, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, KTAV Radio. For more information on how you can advertise your business, event, or services, please visit us online at ktav.tv or call 619-246-6131.
All right, we are back here in studio with Kristi Hines Baker of Kristi Love Connection. So when you started Kristi Love Connections, KLC, what need did you want to meet? When you were like, I'm going to do this clothing business, what need did you want to meet?
Plus size, we're always on the back burner. We're always on the back burner.
Right.
It's never anything cute. You just got some sheets up in somewhere and think that's what we want to look like.
Right.
And it just, I've never been like that. I've always had fashion sense. As a young girl, my mom used to have my clothes made when there was really nothing out there. That
right.
was a little girl, because I've been heavy all of my life.
Right.
And so as I got older, you know, shopping and all that kind of stuff, you know, I just would find what was good for me. I didn't want it to look like other stuff and, you know, old lady stuff and all of that stuff. So the need is a plus size need. I realized what I do notice now is that the plus size industry is growing.
Right.
There's a lot of people that are involved in it. But I believe that it's my passion. I believe that God purposed me for it because I'm able to speak to it. I've
right.
been smaller than this. Mm-hmm. I've been heavier than this. Mm-hmm. I'm kind of like just in the middle,
right.
riding the wave, but I'm going to be cute everywhere I go.
That's
so
good.
That's just how I, you know, I know that's what the need was. To me, plus size. And plus size women, most likely, most of us, we don't like being big. We don't like being criticized, ridiculed, all of those things.
Right.
Fat shaming, all that stuff. All that stuff is real.
Right.
We don't really like it. Some people think they can get away with it and we don't know it. We know.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
But those types of things, God gave it to me.
Right.
Ministry, because we need to heal again from the inside out.
Right.
And we need to know I'm beautiful at whatever size I am. When I exercise, do I need to exercise? Do I need to keep healthy? Do I need to do other? I promote all of that stuff.
Right.
Let's go.
Right. But while you're in transition.
While you're on your way to your better and
right.
your greater.
Right.
You still need to be presentable and you
look
can
good.
Still be cute.
Right.
At the same time.
I
yes.
love it.
Yes.
I read an article, I would say probably a couple months ago, where the fashion industry, they were under the spotlight because in the sense of plus size mm-hmm. fashion, mm-hmm. the fact that things cost more mm-hmm. almost to a gouging. And one, it was the price discrepancies. Two, it was the availability of fashionable clothing. And then the third thing that the author was saying that they were looking at in the fashion industry is they were missing a market because they, for so long, they had catered to like the zero to size eight. Yes. And that was the limitation.
Yeah.
It was like zero to eight. And anything beyond that scope was largely ignored.
Yes.
How they were missing out on dollars and they were missing out on the opportunity to really, from a monetary standpoint, really reap the benefits of providing fashionable quality clothing for women who were in the plus size category.
Yes. You know what I love?
What?
Having my boutique set up. Say I'm vending somewhere. Everything's set up. And a woman of a smaller stature comes up and say, "You're prejudiced. You don't have nothing for me." And I laugh. I'm like, do you know how many years I walked in the stores and could not find one thing?
Right.
Could I yell, "You prejudice"? No. I had to keep moving until I found something or whatever. And I tell them, this is your section right here. This little small section. Everything else is for us. And most of them are like, really? I'm like, yeah, really. That's how it works over here.
Yeah, but that's, it's funny because what you're doing is kind of a microcosm of a macro, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Because in the actual outside of Kristi Love Boutique,
yes,
when you go into a store, like there are times when I will walk into, whether it's Macy's or whatever, and I'm like, okay, you know, and I go into the section and I look like, yeah, okay, and we're done.
Right.
Like I'm done.
Right.
There's nothing.
Or
here.
The one dress that's $100 or $150 or $120 or whatever, and you need three.
Right. And the quality is poor.
And the quality is poor.
Right.
Or it looks like somebody's couch. And we don't want to look like nobody's couch. We are not the big comfy couch.
Or the drapery.
Exactly. It's like they don't think about us. But so I choose. I have designs. I have sketches.
Mm-hmm.
I work a full-time job, so I'm not able to. I can sew. I'm not able to do any of that right now. Mm-hmm. I am, but I do purchase from vendors. And but even that has to be a craft.
Right.
Because you can get a shirt and I can get a shirt.
Right.
And then we put it on a big girl.
Mm-hmm.
And then you see through it because somebody chose a lesser quality.
Right.
You got to have an eye.
Right.
You got to have an eye still. You got to, it's something I love. Mm-hmm. So it's like, okay, I'm not going to, I got to think. What if, be honest, we bend over and something splits.
Gotcha.
Because I'm just like, oh, I could do this. Let's buy some clothes and sell them. No, it doesn't work like that. You have to really have an eye. I've built relationships. I mean, I have vendors from New York on. So Texas, all of that. So I take my time. I take my time.
But I think just from the outside looking in, listening, I think that's one of the things that makes you so successful. And it's one of the things that'll make you in the near future a household name because you're not looking to make money, even though you're in business to make money.
Right.
You're really looking for, I want to give women who are currently plus size the ability to have good clothes, good quality clothes to choose from so that while they're on their way to their better, they can still look good in the process.
Yes.
Absolutely.
If it was about money, I would have stopped.
Right.
I would have stopped. Any business, first of all, let alone this, you know what I mean?
It's
a couple of years before you see anything.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, you know, like again, I say I work a job. I mean, I've taken from that, you know. I've been on the road, I'm chugging right along, and all of a sudden it's like, okay, something, a whirlwind comes through or an event comes through, you know? I'm a perfectionist. I like everything to be right.
Right.
Nice.
Right.
And all of that.
Right.
So sometimes I overdo. I mean, those are lessons learned that you learn along in business, period.
Right.
But yeah, if it was about money, it'd be easy to give up.
Right.
But you know what? I don't expect it to always be like that.
Right.
So, you know what I mean? Eventually it's going turn around where all you see all of that, they'll reap all of those benefits financially, and I'm waiting on that, but it's not going to deter me from doing what I'm supposed to do.
And in the process, you're helping so many women.
Yes.
You know what I mean? There's, and I'm not trying to, you know, be prophetic or anything like that, but I honestly believe that there's going to come a time, Kristi, that God's going to let you see the impact that you've had on women's lives.
Wow.
Because when you can heal a woman from the inside out.
Right.
You know, I thank you, Lord God. There's a quote that came to my mind that says, when a woman is loved the right way, she becomes 10 times the woman that she was before.
Yes.
And so when you can heal a woman in that area, in how she feels about herself, then when you stop thinking about how you look and you stop thinking about the external because you're not focusing on the pain and the brokenness, because I look good. I like the way I look. I don't care if you like it.
Right.
I like the way I look.
There you go.
If you there don't you like go. It, I would like to invite you to build a bridge so that you can get over it.
Right. But you know, that confidence is so attractive in women.
Right.
That confidence is so attractive in women.
Yeah.
So with that being said, you will just, people will see you in a different, whole different light.
Right.
Because you're saying, like you said, it's healing from the inside.
Yes.
They'll see you in a whole different light.
Yeah.
Prime example was we laughed about a dress.
Yeah.
From last night.
Yeah.
That's a whole different woman.
Right.
From the first time I met her.
Right. Oh, I love that.
A whole different woman from the first time I met her.
Right.
And she knows it. She said, I feel like $1 million.
And that's the key.
It's the key.
Right.
It is absolutely the key. It's absolutely the key. The inboxes, the text messages, the direct messages that I get. And like you said, you believe God. And I hope I'm praying that what you said comes to pass for me. Mm-hmm. But just the one at a time keeps me going.
That's awesome.
The one woman at a time keeps me going.
Absolutely love that. So how has KLC evolved from when you first started to right now?
Let's see. Okay, so I've been in business almost 2 complete years now.
Congratulations.
Yes, yes. It's been over a year and a half and over, so almost two. It's, to me, it's growing.
Yeah.
I've been doing the work. I have been at every vendor opportunity I can. I have spent my money on vendor fees.
Right.
Sometimes to come home excited, and sometimes to come home like, oh my God, I left my children and I didn't make any money.
Right.
But guess what? Each time, God always reminds me, because there's either a connection made or I come home and the next 2 days I got an order on my website.
Right.
So, you know, you just got to trust God through that process.
Right.
I believe that my span, I'm reaching outside of just the San Diego church walls.
Yeah.
I want to saturate that, but I want to go further.
Yeah.
I believe that I get calls or something, like I said, orders or something like that all the time. So I believe that it's really, really growing.
Mm-hmm.
Going on my second year already in planning for May Day, my charity event.
Yeah.
And I already gotten calls about that. Already gotten, you know, different things like that. So I think that the name is becoming more and more, more and more. And I one thing, Simone, when I started this, I started it with prayer, the business, and every move I make. If I haven't done it, been so keen on anything in my life, it has been this. I mean, I love my husband. We've been married 10 years. But this business has kept me in prayer because I don't want to move to the right or the left unless he says it.
That's good.
So it's been a faith walk, all of those things, but I'm feeling I know when I make a move in the business, I know it's right because I've been on my, I stay before him in that. I don't want to waste time, money, all of those types of things. So I stay before him on it. And this journey has been great. It's been awesome.
Oh, I love it. I absolutely love it.
It's been awesome.
Looking back over the 2 years, what are some lessons that you learned along the way, or what is one key lesson that you learned along the way that you would want to share with budding entrepreneurs?
The one thing I mentioned was don't be disappointed if you're somewhere and you don't feel like you got a pocket full of money.
That's
one thing.
Okay.
Don't be disappointed because there's always a connection. There's always something. Mm-hmm. There's always somebody who did not know you before you were there, sitting there all those hours. There's always somebody, and it will come back to you.
Right.
Don't get discouraged. And the bottom line is, this message, I know we see memes and different things like this, keep going. Mm-hmm. I've hashtagged it 10,000 times, but it's the truth.
Right.
You have to. You have to keep going. I have entrepreneur friends mm-hmm. that are starting out, and I'm like, I've only been in for 2 years. Why do I feel like I always have mm-hmm. something to say? Or, you know, I don't want you to think I'm trying to tell you. I'm just trying to help, you know,
right,
because
right.
of what I've been through.
Right.
So I think the main key and it is that you can't stop. You just
right.
have to keep going. It's going to get difficult. It's going to get tough, but you got to keep going.
I love that.
Got to keep going.
Yeah.
You really do.
It makes me think of one of those picture quotes I've seen where it says, you know, what people think entrepreneurship looks like, and it's start
yeah.
and it's a straight line to finish.
Yes.
And then they shows, no, this is what it really looks like.
Yeah.
And it's more of, you know, that, the line that you would see on EKG.
Yes.
Where it's like up and down and
yes.
peaks and valleys.
Exactly.
But that's life in general. You know
very
what I mean?
True.
And all of those things represent the fact that you have a heartbeat.
Yes.
Represent that you're still here.
Yes.
So keep going through the peaks and the valleys.
Keep going.
Yeah.
Keep going. That's what you have to do.
Absolutely love it. All right. We are at time for a station break. And so we'll be back right after this commercial. All right, we are back here in studio with Kristi Hines Baker. If you're looking for her on Facebook, it's Kristi Hines Baker. You can also find her at Kristi Love, L-U-V, Connections. And what is your website?
kloveconnection.com.
Okay, and love is L-U-V, not L-O-V-E.
Right.
So, Kristi, so let's talk about the fashion, because you're mm-hmm. in fashion, right?
Mm-hmm.
What makes the fashion industry or being an entrepreneur in fashion different from, you know, other ventures? The obvious and the not so obvious.
Let's see. I think, well, again, fashion, and then we have to use the plus size because
mm-hmm.
that makes it a little bit different. I will say that it is growing, and I said that before, it is growing. There is more available to us,
mm-hmm.
but I think in fashion, you just got to get out there because it can be cutthroat like other things. You know what I mean?
Right,
it can
right.
be cutthroat. You
right.
have to get out there. You can't limit yourself to just saying, I'm doing this and this is how it's going to work. You know
mm-hmm.
what I mean? I've fashion shows, fashion week, all of those types of things. If you're going to grow, you got to put yourself out there.
Right.
And fashion can be, just like I said, cutthroat. You can make or break you, especially if you're styling, which is what I love. I love to take somebody and just say, come on, let's do this.
Yeah.
And you can hit or miss. Man, I follow stylists all the time.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, that was good. Oh, not so good. And people are rude, of course, and can
right.
tell you on social media straight, oh, you missed it on this one. You know, stuff
right,
like
right.
that. So it depends on who you are and what you are. You edgy, you're not edgy, all of those types of things take into effect. You got to kind of like just go out there and do it
right.
and get your feet wet, make your mistakes, do all of those things.
That's good.
Yes.
How did you find your style? How did you find your signature style?
I think that helped me knowing what looks good on me.
Right.
you have to try different things.
Okay.
You know, even if that's at home in the mirror mm-hmm. or in the shopping center or whatever, and you're trying on, not so good, yes, so good, or whatever. As a plus size lady, I don't want to be bumpy and rolly. That's right. Just, it is what it is. I believe in all the foundation in the world that I could wear. That's whether it's one, two, or three. My models will laugh at me to this day. How many of you got on? As many as needed. So, you know, you want it to look appropriate mm-hmm. and fit you.
Right.
If you're kind of like calm, you know, I'm kind of crazy and wild, like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I change my hair every other day, all of that kind of stuff. I'll do that.
Right.
But I'll do that according to an outfit or, you know, something like that or where I'm going.
Right.
The attire, that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That matters to me. But if you're kind of reserved and quiet, an outfit may not necessarily be something wild, but it doesn't mean you can't be nice.
Right.
Or what I've taught or tried to convey to my customers mm-hmm. is just because we got a little extra meat, it does not mean maybe something off the shoulder is appropriate for you.
Right.
But maybe something that's not so short.
Right.
Is not appropriate. And it's okay. We all have fashion, dudes or don'ts. I
right.
think even the smallest person,
right.
you know, you even though you're small, it doesn't necessarily mean your legs are great.
Right.
So why would you wear something short?
Right.
Leggings, if it's got a long shirt, a dress, I'm good. Leggings don't look good on anyone to me.
Really?
With a short shirt, like a crop top?
Oh, yeah.
Unless you're at home chilling with some popcorn in a movie, I think that's good. So, you know, it's just, but that's Kristi's person. You know what I mean?
Right,
how I feel. But those, I think my style came from just experimenting and stepping out. Because there are times when I may say, I might be uncomfortable in that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'll put it on. My older children will mm-hmm. be like, Mom, that looks good. And then I'm like, okay, let me just keep, you know, wearing it. You know, you got to get comfortable because mm-hmm. you're more confident when you're comfortable.
Right.
So I think that has evolved into what kind of a dresser that I am.
Okay. That's really good. You were fortunate enough to grow up with parents who instilled in you your value regardless of your size.
Right.
So talk to our audience, talk to the women in our audience who struggle with self-esteem and self-worth issues because of fat shaming,
yes.
whether that's from their childhood or in their adulthood. Talk to us about that.
Yes. As a child, a young girl, I was heavy.
Mm-hmm.
And you get children in school, kids can be mean. And you get children in school, you know, saying different things and, but if you can get used to that, and that stuff can get, not to get deep, but it can get in your spirit, start believing
right.
it, as opposed to saying, I am this great and wonderful individual, and I am, it doesn't, fat people that have never been heavy
mm-hmm.
don't understand that. Because I look like this on the outside,
mm-hmm.
I can be intelligent, I can be the top of the class and the smartest. But because I am all of those things, they don't want the people to see that intelligence or that I'm number one or that. They want them to see what the physical outside appearance.
Right.
And so it tends to be their problem
mm-hmm.
and not our problem. But mm-hmm. because they instill that in us and we let it creep in,
right.
then that woman gets that low self-esteem.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you've never been heavy, and then you have a baby,
mm.
and you gain some weight, and then it gets kind of like, oh, I'm going to lose it.
Mm-hmm.
You don't lose it, and then you get a little bit heavier. So then you get uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
When we're uncomfortable, sometimes we're not at our best.
Right.
So when we're not at our best, well, let me just throw this on,
mm-hmm.
because I'm big, and I don't know how to get, you know. But this person has never had, you know, never been heavy.
Right.
So I've been through all kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So when I say that, I done been to Weight Watchers. I done been to Overeaters Anonymous.
Mm-hmm.
I done been through all of that stuff. Mm-hmm. I done been through it. You got the physical, mental side. Well, you got to physically do this and, you know, mentally do this and do that and do that and do this. And I'm a firm believer. I like Weight Watchers, but I'm a firm believer in just you got to eat right
mm-hmm.
and you got to exercise.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to do those things for your health reasons and your purpose. You know what I mean? Right. I don't want to be that woman that, oh, let me lose 10 pounds for a man.
Girl. Yeah.
It's not going to ever work.
Right.
Because you can lose that 10 pounds for that man and he leaves and you're going to gain 20.
Or you lose the weight for that. So since we're here, let's just segue. And yes. Once again, as the disclaimer stated, yes. The opinions expressed on the Simone Edwards Show.
Exactly.
I really do. And this is one woman's perspective, but I want to talk about that for a moment. There is a detriment to losing weight to get or keep a man.
Yes.
Because if you do that, you will find yourself in a place where if he didn't love you for who you were,
yes,
then you will kind of forever be in a tyrannical relationship. Mm-hmm. Because now he's watching everything you eat.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
And you're not, see, here go the other side.
Girl.
You're not finna watch what I eat. I don't need you to do that. Right. Watch what you eat. Make sure yours is good. You're not about to do that.
Right.
When I met my husband, mm-hmm. I was smaller than this.
Right.
But we've had two babies since then. Mm-hmm. I've gained weight, whatever. But I think starting KLC mm-hmm. has made him more attracted to me.
Wow.
More. I mean, if that's a word, we've never had any issues.
Right.
He's never even mentioned weight. I was heavy. So
right.
He's never even mentioned any of that stuff. But
right.
Just, I think that I'm telling you that the confidence that mm-hmm. we have it. We're already intelligent.
Right.
We're already smart. But because somebody whispers something, whether it be a male, female, mm-hmm. and that fat shaming part that we talked about.
Right.
Okay. So I vended and modeled at the BBW convention.
Go.
Okay. And the owner of it that does the one in San Diego lives right by me. Mm-hmm. So I met her through a friend. Anyway, I went and did that one. And those women have such confidence. They have such, I believe in moderation because that's who I am.
Right.
But they believe in showing and doing what they believe in. Mm-hmm. And that's fine with me.
Right.
Because whatever confidence you need, to get you through, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
No problem. But I, why do we have to have a convention where we only men that like big women come? Well, this, then. Do you see what I'm saying?
Right.
Although I fully participate, I understand it. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying how unfair, mm-hmm. It can be. Do we have one because everybody's skinny and let's go?
Right.
To the convention?
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I just, even in that, every plus size avenue in fashion that I can, I'm going to go. I'm going to attend it. I'm going to see what I can learn because there's going to be something there for me and something I could bring back or maybe something I can share with another woman to help them.
Right.
But it's so one-sided, that mm-hmm. fat shaming stuff, and it goes from kids on up.
It goes all the way to adults. It's so funny. I saw somebody had written something about bullying.
Yes.
That takes place in schools and all that other stuff. And I was like, that's so funny because that bullying mentality mm-hmm. doesn't just end in childhood. It's
nope.
kind of like if you were a bully, some people don't ever lose that. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of like one of the ways I think that women can really overcome the fat shaming.
Mm-hmm.
And I wrote a poem, actually. I wrote
really?
A poem. Yeah, I did. I wrote a poem because
so you gonna do that at May Day?
I will.
Yes.
I will. I will. No, I wrote a poem because real life situation. I was in a place where, someone was really trying to make my life a living hell, and mm-hmm. one of the ways that they and the poem started out, she hated me.
Wow.
But because she had nothing else to attack, she zoned in on the fact that
hey.
I was fat.
Okay.
And so I wrote the poem because I got to a place where I was like, I'm taking my power back.
Yes.
Like, I'm done letting you think that you run the show and that you control who I am as a person. Like, it's a wrap. Like, we're done.
Everything that you're saying right now.
Yeah.
Do you know how many women come to my table mm-hmm. and I want to say that?
Yeah.
I want to say that. because I can see it on them, mm-hmm. or something that they say. Sometimes we say stuff negative about ourselves
right.
to cover up so that nobody else can say it.
Right.
To let so that before they say it,
right.
or say, you know, talk negative about Kristi prior to so that the next person, because I know they're probably thinking it. Mm-hmm. When definitely the person could actually not be,
right.
but we try to do that to take away from what we feel on the inside.
Right.
But if I sometimes I see it on them. And mm-hmm. I just want to just go all the way in. But I wait mm-hmm. until God gives that signal
right.
to begin to use my business in ministry. And he gives me that signal, and we go for it.
Right. Because here's the thing. The misconception a lot of times about women who are overweight is, oh, you must be lazy and gluttonous.
Yes.
And it's not quite.
No.
Because there are some women, and I'm speaking from experience,
yes.
there are some women who life dealt you the blow that it dealt you, and that was how you dealt with it. Your
right.
your life was out of control, and
right.
so you dealt with it through emotional eating,
right.
or whatever the case may be.
Mm-hmm.
And then you got yourself locked into a pattern.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, whenever your awakening comes,
yes.
and I think that awakening doesn't begin with, oh my God, I'm fat and people are talking about me, so I'm going to lose weight. That's
no.
unhealthy.
Right.
The awakening comes with realizing, yeah, I may have gained all this weight
mm-hmm.
because of the things that I went through,
right.
but it doesn't mean that I can't love myself the where I am
yes.
until I get to my better. And
right.
I define what my better looks like.
Yes. You don't get to define that.
Yeah, you don't define what
no.
my better looks like.
No.
I'm not interested in being... Regardless of my size right now,
yes.
I know that God built me curvy.
Yes.
I have no desire to be a size 8.
Yeah. yeah.
None whatsoever. Like
I
zero.
I never have either.
Yeah.
yeah. yeah
no,
yeah.
no, no. Me personally, as a woman,
yeah.
I think women should... I feel comfortable. I feel confident when I'm soft.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So
yes.
that's the end goal for me. I'm not looking to be like ripped and... You know what I mean?
Right.
Like that's not a thing.
And for those
me.
That are, we applaud you.
You'll
and
go
you're great.
For it.
But you don't get to make the decision for us.
Right.
That's the key.
Right.
But some people don't know how to stop that.
Right.
So you get to choose to be ripped, and I choose to be who I am.
Right.
You don't get to embarrass me or talk about me or those types of things.
Right.
And I talk about that in school because my son, I have
mm-hmm.
three boys.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I got six kids, but three girls, three boys.
Mm-hmm.
So my boys.
Mm-hmm.
Two of my boys are heavyset.
Mm-hmm.
Went through the same thing in school,
mm-hmm.
from a young
mm-hmm.
all the way up. And I used to say, let that roll off your back.
Right.
You know, let those fat names and all that kind of stuff roll off your back.
Mm-hmm.
Who are you?
Right.
Who are you?
Right.
Are you intelligent? Are you smart?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have, you understand, you have your family, you have everybody that loves you, you
mm-hmm.
have all of that stuff.
Right.
Some people don't.
Right.
Have all of those things. So maybe he doesn't understand or she doesn't understand the right way to treat people. She's
right.
mistreating you.
Right.
Don't allow people to mistreat you. You tell her you stand up
mm-hmm.
respectfully. No, this is what it is. But it doesn't define who you are.
And that is so key because, and I want to say this, people can say whatever they want to say.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You can say whatever you want to say
right.
about... women, heavyset women.
Mm-hmm.
What you will not do, however, is I will not give you permission
right.
to let your words anchor inside of me. You get cut off at the pass.
Stay inside.
Right.
Right.
That's your opinion, and you can hold on to it, and
mm-hmm.
you can run with it, and you could probably tell the whole world if you want to.
Right.
But at the end of the day, your opinion doesn't define who I am as a person. You don't get to do that. First and foremost, and I really want to speak to women who struggled with this, because I was in that place for a time.
Yes.
No one gets to define who you are as a person but the one who made you.
Yes.
Allow no one to define you.
Yes.
No one. I don't care who they are. I don't care where they're from.
Mm-hmm.
You don't let anyone define who you are. So if you're in a place where you're hurting right now because you've gained some weight and, you know, maybe you were thin before, like me, you know, you were thin before and you gained weight because life circumstances threw you off, or you've always been heavy set, you don't let anybody define the person that God created. Because
yes.
when he made you, he said you were good.
Yes.
And so you need to love yourself in the place where you are now until, to use Kristi's words, until you get to your better. Mm-hmm. And then when you get to your better, you will know, you'll get to your better in an authentic way.
Yes.
Rather than getting to your better because if I lose weight, then he, she, they will approve of me.
Unconditional.
Right.
It's not upon condition.
Right.
I did it because it's for Kristi.
Right.
I wanted to.
Yeah.
It makes all the difference in the world.
Yeah.
It makes all the difference in the world. You keep it, you hold it, you do all of those things because it was me.
Right.
As opposed to all these other conditions.
Right.
This is the reason why.
I love it. Absolutely love it. We are over by 4 minutes. I have once again lost all my stars. So we are going to take a commercial break and we'll be back in just a moment.
Do you have any questions, comments, or concerns about today's show? Would you like to share your testimony or any constructive critiques? Would you like to know how to be a guest on The Simone Edwards Show? Please feel free to email us at thesimoneedwardsshow@gmail.com. We are also available on Facebook, Pinterest, and Instagram. Be sure to follow us to receive updates regarding the show and our other ministries.
All right, we are back here in studio with Kristi Hines Baker of Kristi Love Connection. So, Kristi, because we're kind of headed towards the end point of the show. You have an annual event called May Day.
Yes.
Talk to us about that event. How did it get started? What is its purpose? All that stuff.
So May Day, M-A-E Day, is because it's for a charity fashion show that I put on for ovarian cancer. My mom and sister, oldest sister, both passed of ovarian cancer 11 months apart, the most traumatic time in my life.
Wow.
And along with God blessing me with my business, he's allowed me to have a voice as far as ovarian cancer awareness is concerned. Mm-hmm. So I partner with the National Ovarian Cancer Coalition.
Wow.
And I'm able to give back to them, to the coalition, after the May Day event. And I've had one. This will be my second one coming up May 7th of 2017.
Okay.
And it's just a great time. I build it around fashion, of course, plus size.
Right.
I let one set in for the little smaller young ladies that would like to come and see. I do have a set for them. It's not age specific or anything. I do a casting call and all of that stuff.
Right.
Because I want to be able to appeal to all women.
Right.
All ages. And so we don't, do any of that, but it's charity, Jacob Center, all that. I have it in the community so people don't have to drive far, all of that kind of stuff, because elderly people, I don't want them to, there's plenty of venues out there, but, you're going to the beach downtown, it just makes it difficult. So that's just what God gave me. So I try to have it in the community, have practices, all of that kind of stuff. And it's just an event where last year my response was just like, wow, this was a production, and I tried again. Perfectionist a little bit, so I try to make sure everything is good, in order, timely, all of that kind of stuff. And it's just a wonderful event that hopefully, the feedback I've gotten, people, it's ovarian cancer awareness is something that you don't think about because it's always too late when women have it, when they obtain it. It's always at a very, very late date.
Wow.
So you can get a pap smear, you can get a pelvic exam, you can get all of that and still it not be detected.
Wow.
So it's one of those things, unless you're like really monitoring or looking for it, because I have two prominent mom and oldest sister. I've been tested for the gene, all that kind of stuff. And I get tested yearly. It's more frequent, that kind of stuff. Make sure I get the blood test, CA marker, all that kind of stuff, just to make sure, because I have small kids. I want to make sure I'm good. So
right.
Those types of things. And it spreads quickly. So
wow.
Yeah, so it's really something. But the color is teal, we just try to teal out everything in the Jacob Center and just have a really, really good time. Yeah. I think people really enjoy it. Mm-hmm. And looking forward to the next one.
One of the things that makes you so amazing to me, and I'm a huge supporter of women. I don't know if it's because I was raised by a single mom and I saw my mother struggle to make sure that I was okay.
Yes.
And so I've always been a huge advocate of women. And so sometimes I don't, and I'm going to be transparent, I don't understand women who hate other women.
Yes.
Like for petty reasons.
Yes.
Like I can't, in my brain, I'm kind of like, I don't get that.
Right.
And one of the things that I really love about you, Kristi, is not only are you energetic and vivacious and a go-getter,
but
I love the fact that you take your pain and you turn it into power.
Yes.
You know what I mean? That you take your pain and you transition it and you look for ways to use the thing that hurt you the most to be a help to other people.
Yeah.
I absolutely, absolutely, absolutely love that about you. And I hope that our audience listening today, as well as those who will listen in the future, can pick that up about you. And because of that, will, you know, whether it's they have a cousin or an auntie or somebody in their life who may be struggling with esteem issues, that they can reach out to you.
Yes.
For those who are not necessarily in the plus size category who are listening, that are, that's kind of like, wow, she's doing this thing on ovarian cancer and I really want to support her, her endeavors, how can they get in contact with you to financially support you?
On the website, klovesconnection.com. So that's klovesconnection.com. If you go there, we have the shopping side, which you're more than welcome to do that, but we have the website side. And there is an actual entry form. And you can submit any information, anything, emails directly to me, and I can definitely reach out.
Okay, excellent. Yes. Mm-hmm. Excellent. And so if you miss that or you're in the car and you're driving, send the email to the show and we will definitely forward it on to her. That is the SimoneEdwardsShow@gmail.com. You can find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram all by the same name. Simone is S-I-M-O-N-E, EdwardsShow@gmail.com. So if you would like to financially contribute to Kristi Love Kristi Love Connections.
Yes.
If you'd like to financially contribute to that for her May Day event that's coming up in May of 2017, which is to benefit ovarian, which is a fashion show that benefits research for ovarian cancer, and the proceeds are donated to that coalition, then definitely reach out to us and we'll make sure we get that information to her, or you can do it directly through her website at KLUVSconnection.com.
Yes.
All right. So before we close out, can you give us, what advice can you give to the budding fashionistas, or what is a consultation? I can't talk today. I'm stuttering. We're going to try that one more time. So pause one moment. We're coming back. So what advice do you have for budding fashionistas, or what does a consultation with you look like?
I try to meet the needs. So I try to see exactly what the person is looking for. If it's an event, one special event, or are you trying to change some things in your wardrobe?
Right.
When I do speaking engagements on how can I, because people think I got to have a whole bunch of money. And I'm one of those who don't believe in that you got to have a whole bunch of money to look right.
Right.
I just don't believe it. So if you have a pair of denim jeans, how can I dress that up? Put on a blazer.
Gotcha.
Put on a blazer. Tank top, some heels.
Yeah.
Do something like that.
Right.
How can I have a poncho top? Okay, you got a poncho top. I'm going out for an event, but I don't really have anything else. Okay, you wear your poncho top. You can put on some, they have dressy leggings, leather leggings, feather leggings, different things like that, and some heels, and go out like that, off the shoulder. That's at nighttime, not for church. You got to do things in proper, decent, and in order.
That's good.
Yes.
That's really, really good. So if they want to consult with you,
yes.
Do they reach you the same way through their website?
Through the website, yes.
Okay. Excellent. We want to thank you guys so much for tuning in to our interview with Kristi Hines Baker of Kristi Loves Connection. You can reach out to her at www.kluvsconnections.com if you want to support the May Day event, or if you want to purchase clothes, or hey, if you want to do both, do both. Or let's say you are just kind of in that place of your own personal awakening and you just need some help kind of loving you until you get to either return to your better or get to whatever that better mark is, because you're doing it because you realize that you are already a treasure, you're already loved, you're already accepted, and you're already valued by the one who made you, but you just need a little bit of help kind of putting your style together, I would definitely advise you to reach out to Kristi for some consultation help along the way, and you can talk to her about pricing for what that would look like. Until next time, we will, I'm stuttering over my words, guys. I don't know what's going on right now, but we're going to run with it. So we stay authentic and free here at the Simone Edwards Show. So we thank you so much for tuning in, and we hope you enjoyed our interview with Kristi Hines Baker. We'll see you next time on the Simone Edwards Show every Saturday on this station at 4 p.m. Bye.